Hello, good evening everyone. I'm Zainab Killick. I am a junior in NYU's GLS, and I am very happy to introduce Professor Larry Wolff to tonight's dialogue. Professor Wolff is a Silver Professor of History at New York University and the director of the Center for European and Mediterranean Studies. He works on the history of Eastern Europe, the Habsburg monarchy, the Enlightenment, and on the history of childhood, and has been particularly interested in problems concerning the East and West within Europe. His current research is on the subject of tonight's talk, Turkish subjects on the European operatic stage during the long 18th century, that is roughly from the 1680s through the 1820s, and musical and dramatic representations in the context of European-Ottoman relations. The European relationship to the Turk, Professor Wolff shows, was paradoxical. The Turk represented both the paradoxical other, inspiring, in his words, a balance of fear, interest, curiosity, titillation, entertainment, and even sympathy, and at the same time reflected a sense of intimacy and even identity between Turks and Europeans. On the 18th century stage in Vienna, Venice, or Paris, the Singing Turk was one of the most important operatic subjects through which Europeans explored, first and foremost, what it meant to be European. We are all looking forward to hearing more about this fascinating study of the complex relationship between Europeans and the East, a relationship that has its own complexities today, and are thrilled that Professor Wolff has joined us tonight to add to another layer of understanding to our exploration this semester of issues of diversity and identity. Thank you.
Thank you so much. It's really great to be here back at NYU Florence. I'm very grateful to NYU Florence for bringing me back to talk about this project, which first emerged for me about 10 years ago. I was invited to a conference in Vienna that was called Wie Europäisch ist die Oper? Right? And I wasn't quite sure what to do with it, but it was a moment at which people were thinking a lot about issues of Turkey's EU, possible EU membership, right? A subject which is possibly now finally going to implode, right, in the coming years. And I had the idea of putting the subject of how European is opera alongside of the question of how European is Turkey, and seeing what would happen if I thought about those two questions alongside each other. And I went to the few works that I knew that discussed Turkish figures, and I then discovered that there were in fact dozens, actually hundreds, of forgotten operas and musical comedies about Turks from the 18th century, from the 1680s up until the 1820s. I think this is easier for me if I stand up. From the 1680s to the 1820s, and that it was a bounded phenomenon. It began in the 1680s and it ended in the 1820s. And that made it seem all the more interesting to try and figure out a little bit of what it meant. But for sure, the one that we know, Mozart's Abduction from the Seraglio, which you're looking at there, the little guy in the front is Mozart watching a performance of the Abduction from the Seraglio, is just the tip of the iceberg, right? One of many, many forgotten works from the long 18th century, running from the 1680s to the 1820s. Just to give away the whole show before I even begin, I would say that in answer to the question of how European was Turkey in its representations, I would say that the Turkish figure standing at the center of the operatic stage, and you see him there, it's another production of the Abduction from the Seraglio, was very European. And that he was used to explore issues that were totally relevant to Europeans. He was often in exotic costume, as you see him there, or in the cover image from the book that I showed you before. But the problems that he faced, the issues that he represented on the operatic stage, were issues that the European public recognized and identified as their own. And if I were going to run through a couple of them, just again, giving away the whole show before I even begin, the disciplining of the emotions was one area in which Turks served to illustrate European issues. The civilizing process, yet another issue. issue, in which, another case in which European issues were staged through Turkish figures, and finally, and probably most important, the issue of absolute power, which was hugely interesting to Europeans, both in the state and in the family, that is to say, rulers and subjects, men and women. These were issues that Turks were used to illustrate, singing Turks on the operatic stage, but were in fact issues that were hugely relevant to Europeans themselves. First thing that a historian would do, I have to apologize for the fact that in switching my presentation to the projector, it's fattened a little bit, but that has the advantage here of making the of really impressing upon you the breadth of the Ottoman Empire from the 16th century to the 18th century. As many of you know, it's a gigantic entity based in three continents: North Africa, Asia, and Europe. And the crucial turning point that I'm interested in is the moment in the 1680s where, after the Siege of Vienna, the Ottoman Empire begins to recede, Hungary is conquered by the Habsburgs, and at that very moment, the phenomenon of the Singing Turk is born on the operatic stage. In a geopolitical way, again, this is the most obvious thing for a historian to bring to this subject, I'm super interested in what early modernists call the triplex confinium, that is to say, the point on the map you can see where the purple, the green, and the white of the Ottoman Empire meet, where the Venetian Republic, the Habsburg monarchy, and the Ottoman Empire all meet at a single point in the 17th and the 18th century. And what I'm interested in is the fact that although there is ongoing conflict between the Ottoman Empire and what for convenience I will refer to as European powers, there's also intimacy, exchange, commercial exchange, cultural exchange. These are porous borders. Anyone who's ever worked on this border region is aware of how much coexistence, cooperation, and contact there actually is here. Very interesting for my project, just because the other two powers of the triplex confinium, Austria and Venice, are governed from not only important political centers, Vienna and the city of Venice, but they are also important operatic centers, Vienna and Venice. And I mentioned this just to emphasize that the operas that are performed on those stages are performed with a sense of intimacy with the Ottoman world that comes from being adjacent in this early modern fashion. Very boring to look at, right? A series of dates in international relations from the late 17th century up until the early 19th century. All I want to emphasize here, without reading through them all, is that the whole creation of this phenomenon circles around the period immediately after the Ottoman siege of Vienna and the breaking of that siege, that there's a clustering of operas surrounding the Russian-Ottoman War at late mid-century, concluding with the Treaty of Kutchik-Kainarji in 1774, that it's given a new stimulus by Napoleon's invasion of Egypt in 1798, and actually concludes at the moment of the Greek War of Independence. This is a phenomenon that has an end as well as a beginning. And one of the things that I'm interested in doing in the book, perhaps in overly pedantic detail, is trying to map these operas onto the geopolitical history of Europe and the Ottoman Empire during this period. So Siege of Vienna, you know there are two sieges of Vienna, Ottoman sieges of Vienna, one in 1529, one in 1683. Kind of interesting to imagine the counterfactual history of Europe if Vienna had fallen to the Ottomans in 1529 or 1683, but it did not. And from the moment of the breaking of the siege, you can see the Ottoman tents there outside the city of Vienna, the walled city of Vienna down below. From the moment of the breaking of the siege, operas about Turks immediately begin to appear in the 1680s. And the first principal subject is the subject of the Sultan Bayezid, who was defeated by Tamerlane in the Battle of Ankara in 1402, was famously I don't know whether this is, well, nobody knows whether this is really true, but was supposed to have been kept in a cage by Tamerlane. This became an important subject for operas beginning in Venice in 1689, The defeated Sultan Bayezid as a principal figure on the operatic stage, treated sympathetically in his defeat, right? I mean, it's consistent with the idea of the Ottomans defeated outside of Vienna, driven out of Hungary in the 1680s. What's a little unexpected is that this genre of operas is not triumphalist. That is to say, the defeated Sultan is treated as a figure of sympathy who is able to be at times heroic and times very moving in his defeat. In this particular case, I want to emphasize that this very first one, that takes place in 1689 in Venice, is actually dedicated to one of the Medici princes, the Grand Prince of Toscana, Ferdinando, because the Medici played a small role in the Wars of the Holy League in the 1680s, and they lent their name as well as their funding to the operas that were being composed in the aftermath of those wars. Indeed, the wars are ongoing until the early 18th century. There's Grand Prince Ferdinando, the operas composed by Corrado, Il Gran Tamerlano. It's named for Tamerlane, the victor, but very quickly, right, in this genre, Bayezid, the Turkish Sultan, emerges as the crucially sympathetic figure. 1706, it actually comes to Florence itself, right, to Pratolino, and is performed with the attori, including Tamerlano, Imperator de Tartari, and Bayezid, the Imperator de Turchi. This is, you know, Florence, just outside of Florence in 1706. But the most important version of this is created for Venice in 1711 and revised for Reggio di Emilia in 1719, with Agostino Pioveni creating a libretto that was used throughout the whole 18th century, and Francesco Gasparini creating a score that makes Sultan Bayezid into the star, indisputably the star of the opera. Again, right, we have a 1717 version of this that comes to Florence, right, 1716, 1717, the carnival season. I just want to emphasize that it's here too. And the person who I want to stress and I want to talk about for a little bit is the person who's listed as performing the role of Bayezid, that is to say, Signor Francesco Borossini, who is a tenor of the early 18th century, who takes plays a large role, not just in the opera, but a role in creating this role and transforming this role, working with the librettist, working with the composer, to make the Sultan Bayezid into the leading figure of the opera. There's what little we know of what Borossini looked like. We were told he was a really stupendous, dramatic presence on the stage, and there's very little of the Gasparini score has actually been recorded, and what I want to give you just a feel for it, and then what I want to stress is how influential this is for the version we know best, which is Handel's version of Tamerlano, because Borossini with Gasparini's score goes from Venice to London, delivers the score to Handel and explains to Handel exactly what he wants, how he conceives of the role. So this gives us sort of our first musical sample. We've messed around a lot with trying to make the audio files work for this, and I think we've got them working. Right, Baroque aria for tenor, but a heroic tenor, Bayezid, who is in captivity, going to his death with huge dignity. What I want to emphasize here is that Borossini brings that score to Handel, and as I say, the most famous version of this is Handel's version in London in the 1720s. But I want you to listen to what Handel does with that same aria and see how closely even Handel's London treatment emerges from the world of the triplex confinium and comes out of the Venetian creation by Pioveni and Gasparini. Here's Handel's version. It's better, but very similar. I want to impress upon you how unusual this might seem at first hearing, that a tenor role of that is as sympathetic as this one should have been created for a Turkish figure in the early 18th century at a moment when the Peace of Pasarowitz in 1718 is very fresh. Turkish wars, right, have been going on really from the 1680s right up until 1718, and the death of Bayezid, he takes poison and kills himself in Pioveni's libretto, is presented as not just stoical, as you see here, not just classical, but he's really the European hero of the opera, in contrast to Tamerlane, who is his Asiatic conqueror and nemesis. Just to give you a little bit of a feel for the libretto that Pioveni creates here, right? He's interested in Ottoman pride, right? Non è vero degli Ottomani il sangue non può copiarsi al sangue d'un pastore, right? Can't you know, couple Ottoman blood with the blood of a shepherd. That's it. He won't allow his daughter to marry Tamerlane. But the idea of Ottoman pride, right, understood to be to some extent a tragic flaw in this hero, but a heroic tragic flaw for Bayezid. We could play it, but I think I want to move on and talk for a moment about the death scene, which is kind of a big deal, right? This is Handel's score for the death scene, and you can see that it's to be sung by Signor Borosino, slightly misspelled, but it's created for Signor Borosini, and it's probably the most extended scene for tenor voice created up until that moment. It's kind of a landmark in the history of opera as a whole, as well as the history of opera about Turks. And it's something that Borosini has first worked on with Gasparini, right? The idea that he should have a long, extended, complicated death scene that involves unaccompanied recitative, accompanied recitative, arioso, and aria all together, all brought together into an extended scene of some 10 to 12 minutes of length in which he actually dies on stage as the sympathetic hero of the opera. And you can get a little bit of a feel for, just a few minutes worth of a feel for what Handel does with it. Tamerlane is a castrato. Orchestra. I laugh at your Führer. So, e questa morte il mio trionfo eletto, right, this death is my triumph. It's a strange way of coming to terms with the fact that the Turks have actually been defeated, right, in recent European international relations, to represent a defeated Turk on stage and to represent him triumphing even in his defeat. As you hear, right, the role of Tamerlane himself is sung by a castrato, caricatured here, and the death of Bayezid at the end, reconciling the other figures in the opera, reminds one of what a presence he is in the opera, because by the time you get to the finale, when everyone has been humanized and civilized by Tamerlane's sacrifice of himself, you are listening only to castrati, and you feel the absence of the tenor voice really powerfully. So the absence of the male register is really striking by the time you get to the end, and Bayezid's disappearance from the stage following his death on stage is musically very notable and emphasized in the musical conclusion to the opera. So I just want to emphasize that when I say there are lots of instances of this opera, this is by no means comprehensive, but beginning in Venice in 1689 and ending in Venice in 1799, right, you have a whole range of productions, including Ljubljana, right, Verona, Florence, Turin, Copenhagen, Milan, right, this is just sort of a small sampling of where this story goes. And the one that's performed in Venice in 1799 is still using the same Piovani libretto that was being used at the beginning of the 18th century. Although by 1799, it's pretty clear that Tamerlano, the proud conqueror, is Napoleon, and that the Sultan Bayezid represents the humbled Venetian Republic. That is to say, the points of political references have changed by the end of the 18th century. So there is a whole genre of tragic operas about Turks, right, focusing on the figure of the Sultan Bayezid. But much more common during the 18th century are comedies about Turks. And they begin in the Paris fairs at the very beginning of the 18th century. They involve commedia dell'arte figures in the Paris fairs for popular audiences, right? So this is not just an elite phenomenon, musical comedies about Turks. The one that you're looking at here, you can't read the title, it's Arlequin Sultana Favorite. Harlequin, the favorite sultana. And he's in disguise. In disguise as a woman, Harlequin has entered the sultan's harem on the right, and the sultan is about to unveil him and discover who he has in his harem. So it's a model story from the beginning of the 18th century and will become opera throughout the 18th century, the idea of harem captivity as a subject of musical comedy. Mozart's Abduction from the Seraglio would be sort of, you know, the most famous version of it. It's a little weird from our point of view to take subjects of basically sexual captivity and sexual slavery and turning them into comedies. They all have happy endings because they're comedies, but to some extent they confront what was the very real phenomenon of captivity on the Mediterranean. We know it's one of the great facts of the early modern Mediterranean that there is captivity possibly affecting hundreds of thousands of people, Christians who are taken captive in the Ottoman world, Muslims who are taken captive in Christian Europe as well. But we're looking by the 1680s, we're looking at the beginning of the recession of this phenomenon. With the French bombardment of Algiers in 1682, 1 year before the Ottoman siege of Vienna. And it's with the recession, the beginning of this recession of this phenomenon, which will culminate in the Americans coming to Tripoli in the early 19th century and Thomas Jefferson's first Barbary War. There will emerge a genre in the immediate aftermath of the French bombardment of these comedies at the Paris fairs, which will evolve into a more elaborate form of comic opera. The phenomenon of ransoming slaves, or slaves from the Ottoman Empire, slave captives, real common in the world of the 17th century. You see two French monks on the right paying ransom money to two turbaned Turks in the middle to emancipate two Christian slaves on the far left from captivity. Notice they are male slaves. In fact, the phenomenon of operas about operatic comedies is going to be all about emancipating female captives from the Ottoman Empire, or for the most part, we'll focus on that. And it will not be done by paying money, it will be done by the generous heart of the Turk himself, who will emancipate his captives. Thus, illustrating what it means to be a generous and a magnanimous ruler for European publics and for European rulers. The phenomenon of the generous Turk, right, thus denominated, becomes a very important opera in Paris in 1735, composed by Rameau. But what we're actually looking at here is the ballet in Vienna in 1758 on the same subject, in which you can see the generous Turk, turban, standing in the center, gesturing towards the European captives whom he is emancipating at the end of the opera. And the generous Turk at the end of Rameau's opera is actually a figure of great sensibility who emancipates his captives and then feels grief at sending off the woman whom he has come to love in his harem. The Europeans are celebrating that they're leaving. Sorry you don't hear the last note, because it descends just a half tone. Souvenez-vous d'Osman, right? Just a half tone at the end, the music effaces itself with the half tone descent, right? Just as he effaces himself from the scene of his own magnanimity. But could you imagine a figure of greater sensibility on stage than this generous Turk who asks that you only remember him? And to be honest, I thought about calling the book Remember Osman, because it's largely a book about forgotten operas, and I thought that could also be a cool title before I ended up with The Singing Turk. Comedies about harems. This is one of the famous forgotten comedies of the 18th century, The Three Sultanas, first presented by Charles-Simon Favart in Paris in 1761, but then taken all over Europe, translated into multiple European languages, right up to the end of the 18th century. It's about three sultanas in the harem of the historical Sultan Suleiman the Magnificent, right? The most powerful warlike of the Ottoman sultans, who took the Ottoman Empire to its greatest extent, the Sultan who actually conquered Hungary at the beginning of the 16th century. And here, his dilemma, right, there's no war involved in it. His dilemma is to choose which of the three sultanas he will favor, the Circassian sultana, the Spanish sultana, or the French sultana, Roxelane. Since it's Paris, of course he chooses the French sultana, Roxelane, who, there was a historical Roxelane who was the favored harem sultan, right, the favored harem figure of Suleiman the Magnificent. She was actually from Ukraine, not actually from France, but for the purposes of Paris, she comes from France, and she proceeds to civilize Suleiman the Magnificent, to teach him French manners and to initiate him into the world of French civilization, including the idea of what it means to be gallant towards women, even if they're in your harem, right, is part of the instructive course that she teaches him musically over the course of the opera. She plays the harp, right, and the star of the performance was the wife of Charles-Simon Favart, Marie-Justine Favart, who played the harp herself, accompanying herself as she sang to him, warning him that although he was powerful in war, he too would have to surrender to the power of love. what she's singing as she plays the harp is an aria called Au vous que Mars rend invincible, which we did the North American premiere of in New York a couple of weeks ago. It's kind of an amazing piece and hasn't been performed since the 18th century. It's Au vous que Mars rend invincible. It's kind of quite a wonderful piece, right? But emerging from a harem comedy of the court of Suleiman the Magnificent as performed two centuries after Suleiman's time in 18th century Paris. Travels all over Europe. When it's performed at the German courts, Roxolana is German, and she civilizes Suleiman as a German. When it's performed in England, right, she's a British woman who civilizes him as an Englishman. And it's performed in Italy as well, with her as an Italian heroine who teaches him Italian manners. So lessons of civilization that Europeans are teaching themselves in the 18th century, what it means to be civilized, here imposed upon a sultan. The wars of Catherine the Great against the Ottoman Empire from 1768 to 1774, the Russian-Ottoman Wars. Comedies about Turks, musical comedies, cluster around these wars. Voltaire writes to Catherine in 1768, "These barbarians deserve to be punished by a heroine for the lack of consideration that they have shown till now for ladies. It is clear that people who neglect all the fine arts and who shut up women deserve to be exterminated." Now, I want to leave out the "deserve to be exterminated" part, which is pretty ugly. We could come back to it if you like. But what I want to point out to you is that Voltaire already conceives of this as an opera buffa, right, about harems, right? It's being presented to Catherine as a story about a heroine who is punishing barbarians who shut up women in harems. And he's already thinking about it in the spirit of opera buffa. And if we were looking at the comic operas that circulate around this period, again, this is just a small sampling of them, right? From Ludwigsburg and Esterhazy, right, to Lisbon and Königsberg and London, where the Sultan, or a peep into the Seraglio, is the British version of the Three Sultanas. What I would want to emphasize here is that the one we know best, Mozart's Abduction, right, really continues, right, this clustering of operas around the Russian-Turkish wars. It's originally composed for a visit of the Russian Grand Duke Paul to Vienna, and it's also composed, and this makes it very interesting, in some kind of centennial relationship to the Siege of Vienna of 1683. It's performed in 1782, right around the time of the 99th anniversary of the Siege of Vienna. Mozart, as well as Gluck and Haydn before him, is really interested in bringing what he understands to be Ottoman music into his score, right? The Janissary percussion that you're looking at here in this Ottoman painting, you see the drums, right, in the back, is it clear enough? Is something that Europeans of the mid-18th century, and especially in this period surrounding the Russian-Turkish wars, are really interested in bringing into European orchestras and using to illustrate Turkish scenarios. The bells, right, as seen here on what's called a, you know, jingling johnny sometimes, right, you shake it and the bells ring, you can see the Turkish crescent below. Cymbals and the bass drum are the crucial pieces. And I'm sorry that I don't know whether you can see clearly in the Mozart score that when you get to the ninth measure of the overture to the Abduction from the Seraglio, the triangolo, the triangle, the bells come in, along with the piatti, the cymbals, along with the tamburo grande, the bass drum, creating an Ottoman percussion effect at the ninth measure. Can you hear the bells? And Mozart uses the Ottoman percussion again to celebrate the Pasha, who shows himself to be a generous Turk at the end of the opera. Oh. So what would it mean to be integrating European music with what was understood to be an Ottoman instrumental vocabulary in order to celebrate a Turkish pasha on the stage of a European opera house? In the case of the abduction from the Seraglio, we have a pretty clear idea of what it meant, right? The celebration of the pasha at the end of the opera is meant to address the pasha who is sitting in the audience, who is the Emperor Joseph II, who is present for the first performance of the abduction from the Seraglio in 1782. Timed to the near centennial of the relief of the Siege of Vienna in 1683. And it would be a good example of thinking about how the celebration of absolute power, magnanimously used, was totally connected to European political purposes in the late 18th century. There was probably no celebration of power that would have been more gratifying to Joseph at that particular moment, or indeed at any moment during his career as an enlightened absolutist. Mozart has other things in mind as well when he composes the abduction from the Seraglio. He's very concerned with questions of emotions. Again, I'm sorry this is so small and not legible to you from the back. Right? He talks about the Turkish figure of Osmin, who is central to the opera. It's kind of a role that Mozart composes twice, right? Once in the unfinished opera Zaida, and then in the completed abduction from the Seraglio. Abduction from the Seraglio, most popular opera that Mozart composed in his lifetime, more popular than any of the canonical works that are performed today by Mozart. Abduction from the Seraglio is performed everywhere. It's the work that Mozart uses to introduce himself to Vienna, and he uses it because it's fashionable Turkish subjects at that moment in the late middle of the 18th century. So the pasha's a speaking role. Mozart's very interested in the singing role of the overseer who watches over the pasha's captives in the harem. He says, since we gave the part of Osmin to Herr Fischer, who has an outstanding bass voice, we had to take advantage of such a man, especially since he is a great favorite with the public here. So it's key to the public as well as to the emperor. Osmin's rage will be rendered comical by the use of Turkish music, by which he means those percussion instruments that I mentioned, which are underlining Osmin's rage in comical fashion, putting it in a kind of Turkish quotation, right? In the composition of the aria, I let his beautiful deep tones shimmer. So comical and beautiful at once. And then Mozart spends more time talking about this character than any other character from any of his operas in his correspondence. These are just fragments from what is a very long letter trying to explain how he deals with this character. For a person who finds himself in such violent rage, and Osmin rages against the European captives who he thinks are trying to trick him, and they are. A person who finds himself in such a violent rage oversteps all order, measure, and purpose. He doesn't recognize himself, and so the music also must not know itself, though the passions, violent or not, must never be expressed to the point of causing disgust. And the music, even in the most horrible situation, must never offend the ear, but give pleasure, must always remain music. So it's Mozart's drawing lessons in emotional discipline from his Turkish character, who he understands to be extremely emotional, to be a raging figure. But when Mozart is thinking about controlling rage, for sure the person who Mozart is thinking about is the person he knows best, and that is Mozart himself, right? It's a raging moment in Mozart's life, 1781, 1782. It's the moment of his break with the Archbishop of Salzburg, and the person whose emotions he's trying to discipline are his own. In the case of Osmin, the comical Turkish overseer, we see him sing to himself, if you like, I also have a mind, right? Ich habe auch Verstand. And stabilizing himself on the lowest F on the bass staff. It's a rage that he can barely control. Now, I would say a word about the low F and the bass with the shimmering tones, right? He's a very particular bass, Ludwig Fischer, who Mozart is working with. But if you know anything about Ottoman history, you know that the overseer of the Sultan's harem is, for sure, a eunuch. And what Mozart is doing here is really carefully keeping separate the whole cult of the castrato in the late 18th century from the whole Enlightenment fascination with eunuchs. And when Osmin sings, "Ich habe auch Verstand," right, he doesn't just mean "I have a mind," he's also saying, "No, I have balls," right, is what he's telling the public. No sooner does he emphasize that, does he stabilize himself on the low F, but he loses it again and goes crazy, as Mozart often did. Beheaded, then hung, impaled, hot stakes. Here's the music losing control as the tempo increases. Right, it's a whole European dilemma of what a person with raging emotions is supposed to do to discipline, control, compose, in Mozart's case, literally compose those emotions so that they conclude harmoniously. He works closely with Fischer, the bass, who becomes a kind of an expert on these Turkish roles in the middle of the 18th century. And he also, Mozart, shows us that he understands that a Turk and a European have a lot in common, as he does in the famous duet between Osmin and Pedrillo that you see performed there on the stage, when Pedrillo persuades Osmin to drink some wine. And the two of them discover in the spirit of the Enlightenment that a tenor and a bass, a Turk and a European, have a lot in common after all when they are drinking together and thinking about girls. Long live Bacchus. And you hear the Turkish instruments. Long live the blondes, long live the brunettes. Right, Osmin is a comical figure, right, the figure who needs to be deceived in order for the Europeans to escape, but the spirit of the Enlightenment infuses the whole opera, and the two figures can be reconciled harmoniously, literally harmoniously, as they are in this case. If I had more time, I would spend a minute on Mozart's Don Giovanni, in which he speaks about in the catalog aria about Don Giovanni's many conquests: Italy 640, Germany 231, 100 in France, and Turkey 91, and Spain 1003. I just want to emphasize that for Mozart and Da Ponte working together, Turkey is an integrated piece of the European Union, right? It's part of the catalog, right, alongside of those other countries. But I want to conclude by talking about, very briefly, about Rossini, who comes from from Pesaro on the Adriatic coast. Again, you can't see the blue sea there, or the sea in the image down below. That is to say, comes from somewhere not remote from the triplex confinium, right? He's looking out on the Adriatic towards the eastern Mediterranean, where the encounter between Europeans and Turks takes place. I have to remind you as well that Rossini is someone who, though he died in Paris in 1868, is now buried here in Florence in Santa Croce. They reburied him in the 1880s. His lifetime coincides with a period of Ottoman reform, the reigns of Selim III and Mahmud II in the late 18th century and the early 19th century. And it's partly the convergence between Europe and the Ottoman Empire during this period which is going to helped to make Ottoman subjects unoperatic later in the 19th century. You can see even in matters of costume, the transition just from the world of Selim III to Mahmud II already suggests that this is going to become less exciting as a subject of difference in the world of the 19th century. Again, I don't think I have time to talk too much about the ways in which Napoleon's invasion of Egypt in 1798 gives stimulus to this subject, though I will mention that the first ever French performance of Mozart's Abduction from the Seraglio takes place in 1798, right? It coincides with Napoleon's invasion of Egypt. Certainly not a coincidence. I do want to emphasize that if we think about Egypt, the Egyptian subjects, and by this I mean Ottoman Egyptian subjects, are so popular in Paris in the late 18th century and the early 19th century that it's a fabric pattern, La Caravane de Cairo, the Caravan of Cairo, an opera composed by Grétry in the 1780s, performed more than any other opera, the Paris opera, right through the Restoration. And the scenes from the opera actually become a fabric pattern, and there are several examples of it in the Metropolitan Museum in New York, which is where I discovered this rather surprising fact, the idea of opera scenes from operas about Turks decorating people's homes in the world of the late 18th and early 19th century. Returning to Rossini, he's very committed to operas about Turks, and he's the last composer who creates operas about Turks. He works very closely with one basso, Filippo Galli, and creates three major works and a couple of others that one might consider more tangentially involved with Turkishness. L'Italiana in Algeria with a comical bay in Algiers. Il Turco in Italia, about a romantic Turk who comes to visit Italy, and Maometto II, about the conqueror of Constantinople in the 15th century, made into a heroic figure on the European stage in the beginning of the 19th century. To give you a sense of how Rossini understands difference, in Il Turco in Italia, a Turk happens to be visiting Italy, where he meets an Italian woman, a married Italian woman, and they have an extended flirtation that lasts through the entire opera. The flirtation plays upon their sense of difference, as articulated in the libretto. She sings, "In Italia certamente non si fa l'amor così." In Italy, certainly one doesn't make love like that. And he replies, "In Turchia sicuramente non si fa l'amor così." Right? In Turkey, certainly one doesn't make love like that. And with just these two lines of libretto, Rossini goes crazy, right, and shows us that, of course, they make love in exactly the same way. Ever heard two people more musically compatible than Fiorilla and Selim? Maybe more shocking. I mean, that was pretty shocking. A romantic Turk who comes to Italy. There's no harem in sight, and charms the Italian heroine and charms the Italian public purely by his vocal charisma. But to take Mehmed II, right, the conqueror of Constantinople and of Greece, and to turn him into a charismatic basso figure, same basso on the operatic stage, that's even bolder. To be celebrated by his Janissary chorus as Del mondo al vincitor, right, to the conqueror of the world. It's kind of an opera that celebrates, right, at moments, jihad. And if you wanted to understand how you could put that on the operatic stage, first in 1820 in Naples, then revised as Le Siège de Corinthe in Paris in 1826, all you need to know is that it follows the Age of Napoleon. And the whole issue of universal conquest is one that every European of Rossini's generation has lived through and is interested in as a cultural and political phenomenon. And music becomes one of the ways of representing the charisma of the conqueror. Again, I gave this away at the beginning. All I would want to emphasize here is that the discussion that is provoked by Turkish figures, singing Turks, right, in European operas in the long 18th century, from the 1680s to the 1820s, is not one of simple exoticism, certainly not one of High Orientalism, which doesn't come into play, I think, until later in the 19th century, but a phenomenon in which the European public really recognizes itself and its own issues in the Turkish figures who are singing to them from the stage. Thank you. Happy to take questions and talk further.
Longer than a question. I was fascinated by this really, amazing talk. I want you to explain a little bit Walter's comment to Catherine the Great, because I don't know, I was reminded of Goodbye Lenin throughout your talk and all the nostalgia about the Eastern Bloc and the Soviet Union in current popular culture and films. And I was wondering if you think there might be any similarities, because the operas, they were extremely fascinating, but the Turks were sort of, they were really lovable, affable, kind figures, except Walter, and his take on, I understand you're framing it as an opera buffa, and I take that point, but that seemed to be a little bit different for me.
I mean, the word exterminated, right, is very strong. Is that what you're thinking of?
Yes.
It's kind of an ugly moment in Voltaire's correspondence, and there really isn't a way to work your way around the ugliness of that sentiment. It grows out of his deep interest in flattering Catherine at that moment in his career and creating a relationship between himself and Catherine in the sort of furthering of his investment in whether enlightened absolutism can provide solutions in Europe, right? The first fantasy is Frederick, the second fantasy is Catherine over the course of the 18th century. And there's no apologizing for it. It is what it is. He's cheering for her armies to win, which means killing Turks. He's really interested in the idea of driving Turks out of Europe, in bringing the Russians to Constantinople, and I'm not sure whether one would understand that to be nostalgic. I'm not quite sure what you mean there. What I'm interested in is the way that he frames it in this sort somewhat arch comical language of someone who shuts up ladies in harems. Right, creates something that balances between, not in a very comfortable way for us, a comical scenario on the one hand and a severely militaristic scenario on the other. And one of the things that's interesting about this particular moment, 1768-1774, is that a real war is taking place. People are actually fighting, killing each other, and dying in the Russian-Ottoman War of 1768 to 1774. It's kind of the first Ottoman War of the century that nobody else in Europe participates in. The Venetians are neutral, the Habsburgs are out, everyone in Europe is consuming it as news from a distance, and nobody's lives are on the line in 1768 to 1774, except for the Russians and the Turks. And I think that it's one of the reasons that we would understand this as being a moment in which comic opera can really flourish as a response to this military scenario. I mean, in a lot of cases, right, the operas, puzzle you. How can you create musical comedy or even musical charisma, right, out of the conquests of Mehmed II? And the balance between what music can achieve, and it's a little bit connected to Mozart's letter, the question of the things that are ugly and the ways in which which music is able to tame and harmonize them for our understanding and our comprehension and our entertainment, I think is relevant to not just the abduction from the Seraglio, but to this whole genre of operas about Turks. Does that partly answer the question?
Yeah.
Let me tell you one thing about the Balkans. Were these operas staged in any of the Balkan area? You've just mentioned Vienna.
Well, Ljubljana, the first opera ever performed in Ljubljana, to the best of my knowledge, is Bonomi's opera about Tamerlano and Bayezid, performed in the 1730s. Later in the 18th century, there are musical troupes that take these operas as far as Habsburg-occupied Belgrade between 1789 and 1791. There is supposed to have been, there's minimal material relevant to this, there's supposed to have been a performance of the Three Sultanas in Habsburg-occupied Belgrade between 1789 and the time when it's given back to the Turks in 1791. I don't know whether you want to think about Hungary in relation to Balkans, because most Hungarians don't want to think about Hungary in relation to Balkans, but it technically meets some of the qualifications for thinking about Balkans, since it was part of the Ottoman Empire from the 1520s up until the 1680s. An awful lot of this material comes out of formerly Ottoman Hungary. That is to say, people's sense of what is a la Turca style comes from, to a considerable extent, from Hungarian folk music, the Turkus, right, or Turkish melody, as discovered by the Haydn brothers, right, by Joseph and Michael Haydn, right, in Hungary in the second half of the 18th century. And some of the sort of Ottoman phrasings, right, come out of the Hungarian world. And certainly right at the edge of the former Habsburg Ottoman border, in Haydn's Esterhazy, right, there is quite a considerable degree of performance of operas about Turks. Haydn's really interested in it. In Lo Speciale and in L'Incontro Improvviso, right, he does really interesting stuff with Turkish material. And although the Esterhazy orchestra is really small, he's got the triangolo and he's got the cymbals and he's got the bass drum and he's using them in Esterhazy. So if you count Hungary as being a liminal space, right, a former Ottoman, now Habsburg territory, you could think a little bit about this work penetrating southeastern Europe. Later in the 19th century, when national opera emerges both in Croatia and in Serbia, those will be places where you will see some Turkish themes from national history staged as opera in the later 19th century, at a time when it's completely vanished from Italian opera, right? The great moments, right? All of our standard 19th century Italian repertory, right? The masterpieces of Verdi and Puccini, none of those are performed as Turkish scenarios. I mean, Verdi writes one huge failure, right? Il Corsaro, which is performed in Trieste in the 1840s and never goes back to it, right? It's probably the least successful moment in his career. And one of the really fascinating phenomena here is that the way in which this subject vanishes from the repertory, but it does survive in the national opera compositions in Croatia and in Serbia, where it references moments from national history, the period of national revival in the later 19th century. I mean, Moldavia and Wallachia are still part of the Ottoman world, right, coming up, right, up until during the period when these operas are being composed, right? They don't become independent Romania until mid-19th century. So within the Ottoman world itself, one of the things that's really interesting is opera comes in a big way in the early 19th century. And not operas about Turks, but European opera, including Rossini, is performed in Istanbul beginning in the 1830s and 1840s. Selim III is supposed to have done one work of European opera in the 1790s, but the records are lost. It was supposed to have been performed, I think, at the Swedish embassy, and members of the Ottoman court are supposed to have seen it. But beginning in the 30s and 40s, European classical music comes to the Ottoman Empire. Mahmud II, when he abolishes the Janissary Corps in 1826, abolishes the Janissary bands as well. Right, the bass drums, the bells, cymbals, and imports to Istanbul the brother of Gaetano Donizetti, Giuseppe Donizetti, who goes to Istanbul where he becomes Donizetti Pasha and composes European-style military music for the new Western-style army of the Ottoman sultans in the age of the Tanzimat. Rossini himself, in the next reign of Abdülmecid, is actually he's given up composing Turkish operas. He's given up composing operas, period, after 1829. But he composes one march for a very large fee for the Ottoman Sultan, right, in order to celebrate the Ottoman Sultan with a European march composed by the great Rossini.
This is such a great talk, and you've raised so many interesting questions for me. And in fact, when you were talking about Hungary, I was remembering your Inventing Eastern Europe and the way in which there's one woman traveler in particular, Lady Mary something or other.
Lady Mary Wortley Montagu.
That's mm-hmm. Who winds up in Belgrade, I believe, and says mm-hmm. she's in a harem, or was it a bath? I can't remember. But she's almost play-acting,
yep.
being in the Ottoman Empire, and
yep.
she's in Belgrade.
Mm-hmm.
But what I wanted to ask about was the sense, I mean, you've convinced us, I think, or me, that this is all about Europeans working out their issues for themselves. But I wonder if the Ottoman setting is possible, because after 1683, you didn't actually say this. I mean, the Ottomans are being pushed back, but after all, the Ottoman Empire was the most important empire in Europe, let's say, up until then, or at least mm-hmm. maybe 100 years before, where you almost, I could imagine, you couldn't make it a setting for something satirical or something
nope.
self-referential, because it was so terrifying.
I think that's absolutely right.
And so, but it's also not at the point where we see it as a sick man of Europe. Mm-hmm. Either. So I'm sort of wondering if this space you're talking about for Europeans, it's sort of an equal, but it's safe, it's mm-hmm. not, I mean, they're still fighting.
I think that's exactly right, Peter. I think that the moment when the Ottomans are no longer as terrifying as they were before 1683 is the moment when these operas become possible. But the moment when they're a clinical disaster, the sick man of Europe, is the moment when the phenomenon is dead, right? The sick man of Europe is no longer operatic. That is to say, there has to be some balance between power and debility, between power and vulnerability, that makes them interesting subjects, both dramatically and musically. And the age of the Eastern question, right, is no longer an operatic age, right? That's already, you know, by then they're a pamphlet, right? And one of the things that's really interesting is that the very last of these operas is Rossini's transformation of Mametto II into Le Siège de Corinthe. When he does that, he transforms it into an opera that's really about the Greek War of Independence, which is taking place at that moment in 1826 in Greece. That is to say, the original Mametto II, the enemies of Mametto are Venetians, right, who have, you know, still lingering crusader presence, right, in Greece. By when he changes it to Le Siège de Corinthe, right, the enemies are Greeks, right? They're fighting against a Turkish sultan, just as the Greeks are fighting against a Turkish sultan in the real world at that moment. And one of the Paris critics comments about the work, if you want to write a newspaper article, just publish it in the Moniteur, right? If you want to write an opera, write an opera. And it's interesting because it's a moment at which the convergence between the opera and the news is so close that there are people who obviously find it uncomfortable. And it's the point at which I think the genre is pushed to a point where it's sufficiently uncomfortable that you can't take it any further. Right? It can continue as a diplomatic question. It can continue as a subject of pamphlet literature. But there's no future for it as opera. after the 1820s.
Just out of curiosity, the countertenor in one of Handel's bits that you showed us, I got the impression that it's used as a sort of almost gendered message, or like to make fun of Tamerlan, but that kind of contrasts to other uses that Handel has for the countertenor, and you know, it has so many arias for a countertenor. So if you know, if you can say something, because it seems to me that you also refer to this fascination with castrati and whatnot, but this seems to me to stray a little bit from Handel's adoration of countertenor repertoires.
So the castrato is a hero in the world of early 18th century Baroque opera. I mean, there's no doubt about that. He's not meant to be a comical figure, the castrato, although we see him caricatured in the fat cartoon of a countertenor, of a castrato that I showed you there. But he's intended to sing in all seriousness in the Baroque repertory of the early 18th century. One of the things that's curious and very striking about the repertory for Singing Turks is that they are almost always in the masculine range, beginning with the tenor Bayazet, who is clearly set against countertenors as a foil, and then descending through the 18th century to the point where, for Mozart, right, it has to be a basso, right, the deepest basso, singing down to the very bottom of the basso range, and for Rossini, it's always a basso, and the same basso. So from the point of view of thinking gender, right, there's an issue of hypermasculinity here, and it's connected to the kinds of issues that I only mentioned briefly, which is thinking about power as it's exercised in the state and thinking about power as it's exercised in the family, say, or the harem, right? Power as exercised between men and women. And I would say not necessarily that it's the castrato who's being satirized for singing in what we think of as the female range in the early 18th century, but rather it's the basso singing in the very bottom of the masculine range, who is being in part satirized, although in part endowed with a great charisma, right, through his hypermasculine low tones. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Professor Wolff, for joining us.